It happened. The unthinkable. The shift that showed our frailty. Nonetheless, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. We are separated. We are isolated. And in this world, we have trouble. Nonetheless, we take heart because Jesus has overcome the world. We are conflicted and frustrated, weary too. But nonetheless, those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. We are down but not out, sidelined but still in the game. We fight for our families, we hold on to love, we strive for kindness, but the hard times get harder. Nonetheless, we are more than conquerors through Him who loves us. We walk through adversity. We are sons and daughters of the Most High. We know to whom we belong, and we know where our hope lies. For He is the first and the last, the Alpha and Omega, the one who is and the one who is to come. It looks bleak, they say it's grim, there's a lot to fear, but nonetheless, we are strong. We are courageous. We are the church.
Enter into His gates with thanksgiving, and into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him and bless His name. For the Lord is good, His mercy is everlasting, and His truth endureth to all generations.
Thank you. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Let's prepare our hearts for the spoken word.
Praise be to our Father, God, forever and ever. Wisdom and power are His. Is there a difficult challenge you're facing today? Are there haters aligned against you because of your stand for righteousness? God will allow us to face some battles. Some will be arduous and disheartening because other people will be involved. But the most important thing to remember is that there can be only one commander in chief. And to be victorious, that role must be filled by God alone. In our discourse today, we will discuss a man who experienced such a time. I'm going to read from the scripture, Daniel 6, verses 1 through 10. It pleased Darius to set over the kingdom 120 princes, which should be over the whole kingdom. And over these three presidents, of whom Daniel was first, that the princes might give accounts unto them, and the king should have no damage. Then this Daniel was preferred above the presidents and princes, because an excellent spirit was in him. And the king thought to set him over the whole realm. Then the presidents and princes sought to find occasion against Daniel concerning the kingdom. But they could find none occasion nor fault. For as much as he was faithful, neither was there any error or fault found in him. Then said these men, "We shall not find any occasion against this Daniel, except we find it against him concerning the law of his God." Then these presidents and princes assembled together to the king and said thus unto him, "King Darius, live forever. All the presidents of the kingdom, the governors and the princes, the counselors and the captains have consulted together to establish a royal statute and to make a firm decree that whosoever shall ask a petition of any god or man for 30 days, save of thee, O king, he shall be cast into the den of lions. Now, O king, establish the decree and sign the writing, that it be not changed according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which altereth not. Wherefore, King Darius, sign the writing and the decree." Now, when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being open in his chamber toward Jerusalem, he kneeled down upon his knees three times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, as he did in the past. Today, I'd like to encourage you to make the choice to have and walk in an excellent spirit. King Darius chose to organize the kingdom by selecting 120 princes to have a degree of authority in managing the kingdom's affairs. The princes would be required to be accountable to the presidents. Now, Daniel had been a great man in the kingdom that was conquered, a ruined kingdom. And he might have been regarded as a stranger in captivity. But Darius noticed that Daniel had something extraordinary about him. And therefore, having found Daniel excellent in prudence and virtue, and most likely, having heard of Daniel being divinely inspired, but Daniel had served God continuously and had experienced many demonstrations of his faith and union with God. So, Darius, having become cognizant of all this about Daniel, Darius made Daniel his right-hand man. He preferred Daniel above the other presidents and princes because an excellent spirit was in Daniel. Even though Daniel was a bit aged at this time, he was as capable as ever in the shrewd and skillful management of practical affairs. So as you can imagine, the other presidents and princes envied him because the king advanced Daniel beyond them. You know, of course, the better a person is, the worse that person is esteemed by rivals. You know the effect of envy. It's everything that is bad. Those who envied Daniel sought to ruin him. They decided, hey, we can't let this go on. We have to bring him down. Seeking to find something they could hold against him, they even engaged spies to get some info on him. But you know what? The presidents and princes themselves could not find anything to hold against Daniel. The spies they hired could not find anything on him. So they finally realized there was nothing, absolutely nothing, they could use against him except his deep and abiding commitment to the law of God. Two of the devil's favorite weapons happen to be strife and dissension. Those envious presidents and princes came up with a scheme to make it a crime to pray to anyone except King Darius. But you know, when Daniel heard of the edict, his excellent spirit stood tall in him. He chose to obey God despite the consequences. He presented himself as a living sacrifice unto God. Instead of being intimidated and fearful, he went home and did what he had been doing. He continued to bow down and pray and worship God right in front of his chamber window as usual. He refused to alter his commitment to God to protect himself. He could have prayed in a room without windows. But Daniel knew that the eyes of more than just his enemies were upon him. God was watching him. Daniel allowed his actions to speak for him. And his actions spoke, Lord, I choose your way. Accomplish your will in me, whatever it takes. And you know the story. He was sentenced to the lion's den for his actions. But God, Almighty God, protected him from the mouth of the lion and delivered him out of the hand of his enemies. Isn't that just like God we serve? Could we choose faithfulness when faithlessness is easier? Obviously, Daniel chose to walk in the spirit and live with moment-by-moment dependency upon and sensitivity to the Holy Spirit. That was his lifestyle. Could it be our lifestyle? It could be, if we decide to allow Acts 1:18 to be alive and active in us. The power of the Holy Spirit was given to allow believers to be effective witnesses for Jesus Christ. This power is expressed through the fruit of the Spirit. And it enables us to be effective witnesses in three ways. One, it attracts more people to the body of Christ. Two, it provides the relational qualities necessary for the members of the body of Christ. Three, it protects believers from the destructive consequences of sin. Now let's remind ourselves of just a few of the attributes of the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit. Well, there's love. Love for all, even those who don't love you. Joy. Joy even in the midst of troubles. Peace. Peace when turbulence and chaos are all around us. Kindness. Treating others as we desire to be treated. Goodness. Good to those who intentionally are insensitive to us. Faithfulness. Faithful when friends have proven unfaithful. Patience. When things aren't moving fast enough, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Gentleness. Gentle to those who are harsh and brass. And self-control. Able to say no in the midst of temptation. Nothing makes the kingdom of God more attractive than believers who live, whose lives are characterized by the fruit of the Spirit. Because the life characterized by the fruit of the Spirit cannot help being noticed. It stands out like a candle in a dark room. That excellent spirit in Daniel caused him to be a standout person. He allowed his spirit to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. He examined his leadings in the light of the word. He walked not after the flesh. He was not prone to slough off. He worked hard to fulfill his responsibilities. His display of honesty, truthfulness, virtue, and moral soundness made him a man of integrity. People with an excellent spirit, standout people, often get promoted. But they're also likely to get persecuted. You cannot please people all the time. So anticipate some criticism, some disappointment, some rejection, and so on. Standout people, those who have an excellent spirit, are persistent. Daniel did not permit the wicked schemes of his peers to force him to dishonor his commitment to God. Standouts with an excellent spirit are protected. God said he will always be with us, even to the end of the world. So let's focus on making sure we are walking and living and having inside us an excellent spirit. Father, we thank you for your unfailing faithfulness and availability to us as we walk in the light of your word to fulfill your destiny for our lives. We would like to offer Christ to you. Behold, now is the acceptable time. Now is the day of salvation. Romans 10 and 9 says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For those of you who desire to accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, just repeat this prayer. Lord Jesus, forgive me for my sins. I repent. I'm turning from sin. I believe that you are God's Son and that God raised you from the dead. I receive you as Lord and Savior into my life. Thank you, God, for saving me. In the name of Jesus. If you prayed that prayer, you are now a child of God. Begin reading and studying God's word and begin attending a Bible-believing church, and it will do you well. Be blessed and be a blessing. Go with God, saints. Be blessed and be a blessing.